To part three. Hopefully, this is the last part. We'll see as it goes. So, the question is, how do we go about solving the pixels, right? The pixels problem. So, first things first, right? Remember how we normally change the pixel. I need to go through and remember OBJ image when I call get rows, right? Let's go back. When I use get rows, it's going to return an unsigned int. So I must use an unsigned int for that. I could use an unsigned short, but then let me just use an unsigned int because that's what it returns, right? So unsigned int r starting at zero. So I go through each row of the image, right? So therefore I need to use the object and say obj image dot get the rows for the image. R++. And then after going through each of the rows of the image, I need to also go through each column. So unsigned int c, c is less than my obj images columns. So that dot get calls, right? And then c plus plus. And then we apply the filter, right? And then here we're going to apply the blur filter. So basically blur the image, right? So you might ask yourself, what about this number of times, right? So remember when you blur the image, when you blur the image here, I'm going to blur each pixel once. So this whole all of these for loops, right? These two for loops, they will blur the image once. And here they said you should blur it a specific number of times. So there's the number of times there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut this, right? And first things first, I go through the number of times. Unsigned, I used an unsigned short, right? So unsigned short int, I'm going to call it t to represent times, and then number of times t plus plus. So now this for loop will go through the number of times it should be, the pixel should be filtered, right? And then within that for loop, I put in the for loop that filter the for loops that filter the image once. So these two for loops here will filter the image once. Once if it is filtered it once, we go back, we count the number of times, we filter it again. Basically go through both the for loops. We go back again, we filter it again. We go through the two for loops again. Then we go back, we filter it, and then until we've reached the maximum number of times we can filter the image. So these two for loops, they filter the image once, so therefore they need to be within this for loop that goes from that goes through the number of times the image should be filtered. So we have this, and then for the blur filter, so remember what I talked about, right? I talked about us rounding off. So in C++, there's a round function, right? Basically, it's stored and it can be accessed via the CMath library because it's a math function, right? And then round, there's two ways you can call it round. You can call it like this with one parameter here. So when it has one parameter, right, it's going to round it to the nearest integer, right? And you can also round off, I think round off in terms of decimal places, if I'm not mistaken. There's the parameter, and then here there should be decimal place. That's the second parameter. That's the second approach you can use it. But then we wanted to round it off to the nearest integer. So we'll take in a double within the function here. So we use the one that takes in one parameter. You could Google online and find out how many parameters it takes in. Let's just try and do that. So let me just say round function in C++. Where's that? What is it called again? Yeah. So go to the C++.com website. So you see, it actually returns a double, right? But then that we can cast that back. Let me see. Yeah, it returns a double. You see, oh, it only takes in one parameter. I thought it took two. That's fine, which is perfect. Because we want to round it to the nearest integer. Yeah, so you see, if the value is 2.3, it'll be rounded to 2.0 because remember you only round it if it's 0.5. If after the decimal point there's a 5 and above. So you see 5.5, there's a 6, you can then so forth. So that's the round function. So let me see if I can find okay, so there's a CMath, right? So these are all the math functions that are there in the math CMath library. So we want the where's the round function here? Okay. So you see, we round to the nearest, right? There's also functions like round to the nearest and cast it to the to an integer, right? Remember, because why do we have to do that? Why do you have to call that function? So that we don't cast ourselves. But then I'll show you how to cast. So we have this function, right? It takes in a double because obviously that we want to round it, round off a double, but then it actually returns a double. So we need to cast it to an integer, basically convert it to an integer because we'll be working with integers. That's why there is different round functions. There's this one whereby called L round. It automatically returns an integer after rounding. We can call that one, right? So there's two ways you can go about it. You can call that one, or you call the round function, the normal one. I'll call the round function and I'll cast myself. I'll choose that other way because I just want to demonstrate how to cast. So since we'll be using the same math library and we'll be using it for both children, so I'll put it in my base class. So that I don't include it inside of each children or each child. So no, I want to use C++ libraries, right? So that's why I'm using these symbols, right? So now I will have access here. And notice something here. Pay attention. I didn't say using namespace standard inside of my ujfilter.h, right? I could if I wanted to, but then it's me, I wouldn't do that. I don't see the need. So that means every time if I use something from that now standard namespace, remember the round function is stored inside the standard namespace. So I would have to specify which namespace I'm getting it from every time. So this is our formula, right? So this is a pixels, right? Let me show you how simple this thing is. So I'm gonna take this and then put it inside of a comment. Like this, right? And then I'm gonna put it the multi inside a multi-line comment, right? So there we go. So if we check here, right? Okay, there's something that I forgot. Where is it? Utility-lib, right? It is the record structure RGB color. I'm going to make use of RGB color, so therefore I need to include it inside of my base class's header file. Remember, I'm doing this way so that it can be included in both children. So I need to include utility-lib because I want to make use of RGB color. That's why I'm including it there. And I include it inside of my base class's header file so that all the children have access to this. So remember this pixels, right? What data type are they? What data type are they? They're going to be each RGB color. So actually, I don't have to put a comment because I want to show you something very interesting. How easy it is to convert this thing to code. So remember, C++ needs more details, or a programming language needs more details to understand. So I can't just say current pixel, it'll be like, what type is it? So we know that it's going to be an RGB color, but then Dr. Stung will use the color with the U. So this color needs to have a U. So all of these will return RGB color. And make sure you put a space after the variable name and the data type, you see, because it will think this is one word. It will get confused. So after the data type, I put a space. Programming is not, should it shouldn't be something that you stress about. As long as you understand how it works and how to convert, you see. not done, right? Remember, each statement, just like in English, each sentence is terminated by a full stop. So in C++, you terminate statements with a semicolon instead of a full stop. So we need semicolons here, or else you don't know where the sentence ends. But then in C++, sentences are called statements, not sentences, because we are not in English here. We are in C++. But then these are the roles, these are the coordinates, right? Of me trying to get the pixel. So therefore, next to this, I need to say obj image dot get color. It's called get color, not get pixel. You need to use the name of the function that was created for you. You see, that's how simple it is. So obj get color, these are the coordinates, because I already solved the coordinates. I calculated them on the side. So now I don't need to stress myself and type. I'll just put it in before the opening curly, the opening round bracket, to make my life easier. There we go. So now I've gotten all the pixels. That's actually all you needed to do to get the pixels, as long as you knew the coordinates. So now I have all the pixels. So this is how we're going to work with the pixels, right? Let me show you how. For us, it's going to be different than the way I showed you in the other video, right? That was a grayscale image. Us, we're going to have a pixel. So a RGB image, right? It's not a grayscale image. So imagine this is our image, right? Just imagine we have a point. Let's say we're currently here, and then let's say this is our point here. Remember the Cartesian plane. For us, it's not one value at that point in our Cartesian plane, like 4 or 2 or whatever that value we have there. It's not going to be one value. It's going to be a pixel. What does it mean? It means that it's going to be like a curly braces of three values: R for red, G for green, and then B for blue. So at every single, come on. So at every single code pixel, right, or a point, you're going to have a collection of three colors everywhere, even that side, even going down, even at every single point will have three values, right? So now, if we have three values, since I made an example for only one value, how do we go about solving it? So the way it works, right, you look at all the surrounding pixels. You take all their red color components, right? You sum them up, you multiply and then add them, and then divide by 9 to get the average, right? Or the mean. And then remember, we need to round off. That's the formula. After dividing by 9, we round off to the nearest integer. Once we are done, then we set this pixel, the red pixel, because remember I said we only take the red color components of the pixels surrounding this pixel where we currently at. And then add, multiply, add to find an average. Once you find the average, then you set the center of the current pixel's red color component to that color comp to that average that we've gotten. Remember, when you're calculating this, right, you also include the current pixel. So how do we do that? It's simple. Remember what I said, all of the surrounding pixels, you calculate for the red and green. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to declare them outside here. So I know for a fact that my pixel colors might be negative values, right? That's why I made the kernel array to be a short int, basically signed. So therefore, the variables that I'll create to short to store the red, green, and blue, I'll call them red, green, and blue. Remember, if something is of the same data type, you can declare it in one line separated by a comma. What this means is like create a short int that's named red, another short int that's named green, another short int that's named blue. So what I'll do so that I get different values, right? This is important. So that I get different values, I'm going to always initialize it to 0. So I'm going to initialize it to 0. Where? Within my columns loop. So I'm going to say is equals to 0, or else my colors will be mixed. It'll keep adding and adding to the current average and things like that. It doesn't really matter. I don't have to initialize to 0 to be, if I'm being honest with you. I don't have to. Yeah, okay, I don't actually have to, but then obviously here at the top, before I use them, I need to make sure that there's no weird values inside. They're initialized. So I don't have to, because why? Why am I saying so? Because I'm going to initialize them at the end of the day here. So I'm going to say set or calculate. Let me phrase it as calculate the red color component. So how do you calculate? So I'm going to say that variable here. So I'm going to say red, right? I don't know why Ishmara doctors too. I don't know why he used unsigned though here, because remember these pixels, the pixels won't exist. You might get it might complain. Because let me show you why it might come. Let me see. It might not, might. Let me just double check. Okay, it turns RGB color. What is the data type inside each? Lucky enough, it's int. If inside each here was unsigned, then these red, green, and blue variables, they would also have to be unsigned, or else you're gonna get that error of unsigned. What you can't compare something that's signed and unsigned to each other. That's why even the author of C++ doesn't advise you to use unsigned. He says try to not to, he made a mistake creating that inside the language. But that's something you shouldn't overuse unless you have a solid understanding of unsigned. So I'm going to have red, right? All of my red my red color components. Remember, it includes also the current pixel. Everything you should take, it includes also the current pixel. So now I'm going to take all of my pixels, right, including the current pixel and its surrounding pixels, and take the red color components. So int red, only red, because remember that's how I'm going to calculate this. And times, this is the tricky part now. So by times, remember what we talked about. You need to times it by the value at corresponding to each other, that specific position. If I'm taking the top left component of my current pixel, I should multiply it with the top left of my kernel. If I'm taking the top middle of my kernel, I should of my pixel, I mean, I should take the top middle also from my kernel and multiply it by that value. So they need to correspond. They need to be able to multiply values that are at the same position as your kernel. So let me start with top left. So top left's int red times. Remember the asterisk is for times, for multiplying, right? This is the same as multiplying. So asterisk times my kernel, right? So now we need the kernel. What is top left? I know it by head now. Top left is 0, 0. That's the coordinate for the top left. And I'll just put brackets, just safety measures. You don't have to, but just for safety measures, so that I can tell them apart that which one is which. So top left and then top mid is red. I'm still dealing with red only. And then my top middle, what would be my top middle? Remember, I'm still at the top, which is row 0. But then I'm now at the middle, meaning I'm at the next column. I was at column 0, right? So now I need to move to the next column. What's after 0 is column 1. And then top right dot its red color component times it by the chorus, the kernel, which is at the similar position as my top right color component, which is 0 column 2. And then you just repeat that over and over. Remember, you need to sum up the multiplied values. And then now I'm going to have mid left dot its red color component times underscore kernel, right? And then now I'm in the middle. I'm at the middle, which is row 1, but then I'm at the first column. And then the center now, which is the current pixel. So I'm going to use that's the current pixel. Remember this, the formula says including the current pixel of where you are. It should be added into the calculation. And then I'm still at row 1, column 1. You could use a for loop, but then if you use a for loop, you need to actually know what you're doing because you need to find whether they're the same position. What do I mean? Whether the top left pixel that you whether it's you need to find first, is it am I at the top left pixel? If it's yes, then you multiply, but it's equivalent top left pixel in the kernel. So you need to have multiple if statements to check, of which I don't want to do that. I'll just use the actual positions. And then my mid right, that's still times underscore kernel, which is row one, column two, which is the last column, right? Then now I'm at the last row, which is bot, or I call it, I wrote it in full, bottom left dot times, which is the, remember, I'm still taking, remember the red value, it stores only the sum of the sum of multiplying the surrounding pixel with their corresponding kernel value, that position, take that sum and then divide, find the weighted average. After finding the weighted average, round off that weighted average, then you have a new red color component. And then now I'm in the last row, which is row two, but then still the first column, which is column zero. And then bottom mid, which is my middle in the bottom row, red. Remember dealing with the red color component, right? Two, now the column is one. And then my bottom right dot int red. Remember it's red color component that we're dealing with here. Two, two. And then that's it. I'm done with my red. And then I just do the same for blue and green. So this is my red. And then I need to also round off to the nearest integer, right? To the nearest integer. So that means I'm going to reuse the same variable. So I'm going to say red is equals to, remember, round function, right? There's the round function. It's within the standard namespace, so I need to say standard colon colon round off what the red values answer divided by 9 to get the average, right? And don't forget that if you divide by 9, remember this is going to be an integer here. Remember all of these are integers multiplied by integers, so it's an integer. So if you have integers on both sides of the operator, in this case, it's a division operator. If you have integers on both sides, you have to cast one of them to be an integer. If you want to do floating point division, so if you want to get things like 3,5, 3,7, one of them needs to be a double. So in this case, the easy one to make a double is nine. Is nine. I'll just change that to 9.0, so that it does floating point division, so that this round function actually makes sense. Because if I don't put that dot there, let's say the average is like, they say the sum is like 1,000, right? Divided by 10, it's going to return 100, right? And then I'm just rounding 100, which makes no sense. So I want something like this. So if it's like, it's like, what is it? One over three, right? This is going to, one over three is going to be 0.33, right? Recurring, but then if I don't make one of them as a double, it's going to just return zero, and then I just round off zero, which makes no sense. I want to round off the floating point, the result of the floating point. But then remember, we have two functions. There's the L round, which returns an integer, which is perfect, which would be perfect. But then here in our case, we don't want to do that. I want to introduce it to casting. Remember, this returns a double. If you forgot, we can go back here. I'm using round, not L round. So you see, it returns a double. It takes in a double. That's why I had to do it a double division, right? And then it returns a double. So whatever is returned is a double. I want to cast that. How do you cast? There's one of two ways which you can cast. There's a C style casting this way, to say whatever is returned on that side, cast it to be, let's say, for example, a short. There's that way. But then this sea style is regarded as an unsafe way of casting. The other way of casting, the C++ way, right? That's recommended. It's static underscore cast. And then within here, you put the type you want to cast it to. And then you put brackets. And then you put in brackets whatever you want to cast. So let's say I want to cast 9.5 to a short. So this is the syntax of casting it. So in our case, we want to cast this whole thing, this whole result. So I'll do that. Remember, it depends on the data type of what's on the left-hand side. My red, which is on the left-hand side of the equal sign, is a short int. So I have to cast this double to a short int. So let me show you. Cut this, and then static underscore cast, and then cast that to a short int, or just short. It's up to you. I'll write it in full so that you get familiar to, you become familiar to what short means. It means a short range. Looking at the integer, take only the short range of it. Hence, short int. So it's fine. You see the thing here, right? We have the cat with the red pixel, right? We have this, but we still need to change the red pixel of our current pixel because we cut it. Remember what's the formula? You find, you multiply and you divide, get the weighted average, and then you change that current pixel's color component to that average. In this case, I'll call it red. Basically, it's red average, which is the average for the red color component. I think I should freeze my, I should write my variable, name my variable as well. So green average. And then this is my blues average. So remember, to get the average, we need to sum, find, get a sum, and then divide it by the number of things we added up. So I'm going to do this. I'm just aligning everything. Okay, I don't know why I'm taking so long. Could have just done this. Yeah, this is quicker. There we go. So there is, right? We have our code. So we'll do the same for the red and for the green and whatnot, the green and blue, right? But then before I do that, remember we need to change the current pixels red. So current pixels dot its red is equals to this new red average that I've found. So we need to change that before we continue. And then I continue to the other ones. So copy. There we go. Then this would be the green color component, right? So int green. And then all I have to do is just change this. You see, things become simpler when you've solved part of the problem. If you want to use for loop, it's up to you. Remember, you have to use if, many if statements to check whether they are correspond this position of top left corresponds to the top left of the kernel array. This top mid corresponds to the top mid value of the kernel array. You have to check. There's a lot of if statements being used if you choose that approach of doing for loops. And then change this to this to this. Oh no, my bad. It's not divided by 9. I'm doing UJ-Blair filter. Let me show you why I'm saying it's not divided by 9. So I'm going to click here, image processing, and show you that it's not actually divided by 9. You see, we are doing the Gaussian Blair, right? And we have a 3x3 matrix or an array, a 2D array with 3 rows and 3 columns, which is this one. And you see, it's exactly the same one we have. You see, you times it by 1 over 16. And if you remember math, your maths, I don't know, sometimes people forget, but then yeah, if you remember your maths, 1 over 16, let's say times 2, is the same as saying 2 divided by 16. So basically, I'm just dividing by 16. So that's what it means. So don't be confused that, oh, I need to times it by one over 16. You don't have to times it. You can just divide straight. Just go straight to dividing. So it's not actually divide by 9, it's divide by 16. And 16.0, because we want a floating point division, not integer division. We don't want it to divide two integers and return an integer. We want it to divide two floating point values or two doubles and return a double. Because this round function takes in a floating point or a double. And then remember, we need to change here the green color component. Don't forget to make those changes. Okay, so I need to copy it again. And remember, I'm still within the for loop for my columns, right? For my columns. And then paste. And then this is blue, light tint blue. And then copy. I need to change all of this to blue. Because I don't want to retype the same code. Remember, this is just the same formula for the red, green, and blue color component. And then you could have made a method. There's many ways to go about doing this, right? There's many ways. Don't just take my approach. There's many ways you could have approached it. So that's blue, and then blue, and then this is blue. So that's the formula, right? We're almost done. So we've changed our current pixel, but we like how do I put it? We've changed the current pixels red, green, and blue values, but we haven't actually set the pixel to be this new pixel. So the last step, right, is to update our actual pixel by calling the obj image dot set pixel color, which takes in what row, which is current row RC, to what color to current pixel. Before we pass that current pixel, we've updated its blue, its red, green, and blue values, right? So therefore, the current pixel will be changed to this current. It's fine, like whatever variable you've named it. I've named it current pixel because it represents my current pixel. So I'm updating current pixel using the current pixel variable. So this now updates my pixel. If I don't do this right, my image won't be updated. Let me show you. Let me comment out this. And then let me go to my main.cpp. Since I have UJ Blair now, this is fine. So I'm going to build to make sure I have no errors. Let's build and wait. No, okay, there's errors. Oh, before I forget, you see this thing of, oh yeah, you see this thing of changing variables. This is red average. And you see, yeah, using red again. Yeah, that's why they say don't use copy and paste. Totally forgot to change that. Yeah, copy and paste is only for experienced programmers. I picked it up quickly because I have experience in coding. If you didn't have, you'd spend the whole night trying to figure out that error. So it also needs someone who's very attentive to details. You pay attention to details. Even capitalization is important in C++. So I saw students, a lot of students struggling to run and what to add. They gave you a batch file for a reason. Go back to your folder, your project folder. You see that within the project folder, there's a rendered batch, which is a batch file. You have the batch file, so use the batch file. So sometimes, right, if we say G++, worldwide is not an internal or is not recognized. If that's the case, if you get that error, use my terminal, the terminal that I told you to use. So copy the path or the location of the folder there at the top, and then open the terminal that I told you guys to download. And then waiting for it to load. So now I can use CD to change directory, right? And then right click and then paste. If your project has spaces, right? You see mine is underscores. If it has spaces, You need to put everything within double quotes like this. That path that you've copied and you want to paste, you need to put it in double quotes. If your any file or any folder here, there's a space. There shouldn't be any space. You see in my folder, there's no space at all. And then don't forget to change everything to a forward slash because this terminal mimics a Unix environment, right? Which is basically a different operating system. So there's different rules here. To go into a folder, use a forward slash. And then enter. And then I'm going to type ls to list everything inside of my current folder. So that's everything inside of my current folder. So I know I'm in the right folder because I see the UJ Blair filter, UJ utillib, the mosaic, blah, 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 and the run.bat, right? And then I'm going to type clear to clear the terminal and then to run the batch file, right? Remember, this is a different operating system. You can't just say run.bat like this. Command not found because it's a different operating system. It mimics Unix environment. So I have to say dot forward slash to execute anything. What do I want to execute? I want to execute the run.bat, which is the batch file. Then it runs the commands. Don't change anything in the batch file. Okay, we need to change something here. Remember, option E is for the edge. So by default, Dr. Stung put option E for the edge. We haven't implemented the edge class, right? So right now the image is going to come out as default. You see, there's the default image. That's not what we want, right? So I need to open my batch file and change just one option. I don't want it to choose option E. I want to choose option B because option B is for the blurry image. It's when we want to generate the blurry image or the blur image. So I'm going to change that to option B so that the blurriness can be visible, can easily see it. I'm going to increase the number of times to 10. Change that from 5 to 10. And then what I'm going to do is so that we see the differences, I'm going to open the original image here. While that opens, I'm going to run my batch file. So let me show you the original image. There's the original image. You should definitely see the differences. So now it's going to open this thing again. And then I think it's, where is it? Is it this one? Oh, yeah. I was still explaining, right? You see, there's no changes. Even though we wrote code, there's no changes, right? The image is they're identical. It's exactly the same thing. So this is the image that we wanted to that did the result of changing. Do you see any change here? Nope, right? Because it didn't call set pixel color. It didn't call that function. You did change the current pixel, right? That's fine, but then you didn't update it. You didn't update the internal array. So we need to call this to update our internal array so that the changes appear in the array. Then I say I remember, don't forget, pay attention to this left-hand side. It needs to be green. If I do this, you see it becomes yellow. Nothing will, you won't see the changes if you don't save. You can either go to file and then say save, not save. Where is it? I think save project. Is it save project? Okay, no, it's not. Where's that? Okay, let me say save file. Yeah, so you need to click save file, or you can press Control S. Remember what Control is, I showed you in the other video. So Control and the S letter. Make sure when you press Control, right, don't let go of Control. Then you press S. That's how you save. And then you see now on the left panel, it's now green, meaning that the changes that I've made have been saved. Then now I can rerun my batch file with the changes that I've made saved. They need to be saved so that they can appear. And then you see, perfect. Don't you see that this image is blurry? Look at it, it's blurry. Compared to this, if I go back here, you see this is clear. This is now blurry. So if you understand the formula, if you understand the approach, it should be straightforward. So we are done with the blurry image, right? Implementation. So now let's get to the Edge filter. Edge filter is exactly the same as blur. The only difference is the number we're dividing by and the kernel array values. Those are the only two things that are different. So UJ edge filter and name it exactly the way they wanted you to name it in the PDF. I already have it in my brain. I know how I should name it and the capitalization and everything I know. So I don't have to look at that. And then UJ edge filter. And then let me create the corresponding CVP file. So UJ edge filter dot CPP. Then all, then finish. And then hash include UJ edge filter. And remember, we're going to use CC image here, the implementation of CC image. So I need to add the header file there. But then inside of my class here, I won't implement, right? But then remember, I'm going to need my UJ filter file, header file, because I'm going to inherit from it. So it's going to be public inheritance, so public UJ filter. Public inheritance, meaning that I'm going to inherit from that class. Remember, when you inherit from the class, you always inherit things that are public. This public just states that the things that I've inherited, they should remain pub, they should be public within this class or within this child class. And then for a declaration, so CC image. And then public. So basically everything that you inherit now will be placed under this public section here. That's what this public stands for. Then UJ edge filter. And then UJ edge filter destructor. Then we need to redefine. Remember, it needs to match exactly the same way it was defined in the base class. So copy this. Since I'm going to reuse these constants again inside the other class, the other child class, I need to actually transfer them to my base class. And I'm going to make them protected. Oh, they're actually inside of my base class. So not me not being away. I'm actually my base class, so they're fine. I did that perfectly fine. So this should be this. So now I need to go back to UJ filter, right? This is a mistake. This shouldn't be public because no one's going to access them. It's just meant for my children, right? It should be a family thing, so it should be protected. That's if they end up wanting to use it. They don't end up using it, but then still fine. And remember, in the header file, I don't actually need to give the parameters names because in the header file I'm not implementing, so I shouldn't waste my time doing all of that because people have different ways of coding. So I want you to know different ways to code so that you can understand other people, when especially when you go to the industry. Some people end up actually using C++ on a daily basis, so just get accustomed to knowing all different styles of coding. And then for my UJ filter, UJ edge filter. So basically, it's basically the same thing as UJ blur filter. The only th different things is the values. So I'm going to copy this, then put it here. I'm not going to waste my time. So this is going to be the easiest class to implement. Everything else is minus one, except the center or my current pixel. So this is minus one, minus one. So remember, one, one, the coordinate one, one, that's the current pixel or the current center, I mean, for my 2D array, kernel array. Minus one, minus one, minus one. So this edge filter uses different kernel values, but then the implementation is the same. The only difference is the, so I'm going to copy. So this was easy to implement because once you have one of them implemented, you just re-implement it in the other class. So I need to name them exactly the same way. OBJ image. Remember, these parameters need to be matched with the code that I'm about to paste now, or else I'll face issues. So this will be number of times. And then that's it. I just copied and pasted the same code. For now, you might be like, well, we're repeating ourselves. Yeah, that's the whole point. You need to learn the problem so that you see the solution. In the next week's practical, I think there should be things like virtual or things like that. You'll understand that there's ways to do it in a more efficient way. Remember, we're no longer dividing by 16, but now we divide by 9. That's the formula for the edge filter. If I'm not mistaken, that's the formula. Okay, here it doesn't have, to be honest, it doesn't have anything, right? You see, here it's 1/9. The edge, I think we're using edge detection. Yeah. Where is it? Yeah, edge detection filter. So we don't actually divide, right? Yeah, and you see, they don't want us to divide. So I'm not gonna divide. But then it says it. The thing is with the practical, it says that they all use the same formula. So I guess this one just, but then supposed to do, yeah. I think I kind of, not necessarily, but I think I kind of get it. But then you see, yeah, that's the thing. With the practical, I don't know why they were saying that. And then they use a different formula. I don't know. Maybe they wanted to confuse you. But as you can see, next to this kernel, there's no tile 1/ or something. Only when you're doing other algorithms here. Like this one, Gaussian Blair, we had to times it by 1/6 or divide by 16. So that means this one, we don't have to divide at all, right? So that means there's actually no need for this line. It's going to come out looking weird. It did come out looking weird. I think that's why I ended up dividing by 9. I ended up dividing, actually finding an average, because the image came out looking weird. So we'll see just now what I mean by that. So I need to go back to my main.cpp and then include the other one, which is the edge filter that I just implemented now, and then uncomment the two parts inside of my main that use this. And then since I want an edge filter, I need to change my page file again from option B to E. B is for the Blair filter. That's option for the Blair filter. E is for the edge filter. So I'm going to use E because I want to test my edge filter and see if it's working. And then don't forget that when you change something in the page file, you must save the changes. I'm so used to doing it fast, thanks. Control S. I'm just so used to it. So that's why sometimes it just looks so fast. So let's wait for it to open. So there's the image. I'm not sure if this is what actually it's supposed to be. But then there's the image. If it's not clear, right? You see, it's not clear. If you cannot tell, you can reduce the number of times. So let's change the number of times to 1. Let's see how it's going to look if you change it to 1. So let me change that to a 1. So basically apply the filter once. I want to see if that's going to actually improve the image or not. Because with edge detection, you're not actually dividing by 9. Yeah, you see, this is what I'm getting. That's what you get. So that's why I ended up dividing by 9, because the image was not showing, even though in the website it doesn't show the divide by 9. You see, we are using edge detection. You don't multiply, you don't divide, you see. So yeah. So let me show you what happens when I now divide by 9. It actually comes out looking, it becomes visible. So So divide by 9, save, control S, and then go back to my terminal. Let me clear terminals full now. And then run. Then we wait for it to generate the image. You see, that's why I divided by 9. But then on the website, it doesn't say divide by 9, right? The formula. But then if you don't divide by 9, you see the problem, you won't see the image. So if you can, I hope you can tell, but then if you can tell, it's a bit sharper now. You see, you can't, it's a subtle tip, it's a subtle thing, right? So look at this. When you zoom in, it's a bit blurry, a bit, right? It's a bit blurry. And then here you see it's a bit blurry, but then it's like sharpened. You can see the lines and everything clear. So that's pretty much how you're supposed to do it. So that's all you had to do here. And then you can play around with your batch file to change the images and things like that. So you can remember they gave you different images like this one. There's the mosaic, blah, blah, blah. You can use that. But then I feel like this one is a bit clear to see the changes. So, yeah, that's it for this video. I'll upload the code, right? Remember the edge filter and the blur filter, they do pretty much the same thing. The only difference is the value that they're dividing by because of the formula that they're using. That's the only difference. So, yeah, that's pretty much all you had to do in this practical. So, yeah, I hope you can now see where you went wrong and also how to add the files inside code blocks. That's the first and important thing to do. But then I think if you don't divide, let me see. Yeah, I think if you don't divide, the thing is, I don't know. Let me do this. Let's play around with this kernel, right? Let me do this. Let me change this to an 8, right? To an 8 because I'm using the kernel that's there on the website. That's why I changed it to an 8. And then this batch file. Wait, I already closed the terminal. Damn. I have to open it again. So let me change this. Let me give it a bigger number again. And then copy this. Okay, the terminal. I want to test out something because I want to know if the issue is with the kernel values or what. So CD, since my location to my file does not have any spaces, I don't need to put it in double quotes. So dot run dot bat. I want to see if, oh, okay, I wasn't supposed to divide by 9 though, because I want to see if I don't divide by 9 and I use a different kernel values, will the image be different? Okay. Okay, so if I put an 8, it becomes like this. Wait, no, it's fine. I increased it to 10, that's why. Yeah, it was increased to 10, but then that's fine. Let me put back to 5. I think 10 is a bit too big. Let me put it back to 2. 10 is a very big number. That's many times. I want to test out something here. But then, yeah, if you look at the example, this is actually how the image should be. You see, it's weird. That's how the images are, especially if you're using edge detection. That's how the images are. I don't see any clear image here. So to sharpen, we would actually need to use this one. So it's actually an edge detection. It's not meant to sharpen, right? But then I think at the same time, it also kind of does sharpen, because if you look at it, you can see these lines now, it's sharpening in a way. The tricky thing, we can also change it to this. So let me try this one. So it's 0 minus 1, 0. Okay. So it's 0 minus 1, 0 minus 1, 5, 0 minus 1, 0. Let's see if the image changes. So if it ch because we're, I'm now sharpening it. I'm now sharpening it, right? Without this, without using the edge detection, I'm using the sharpening approach. I want to see if it actually did, but then it depends on the kernel values. It does depend on the kernel values. Oh, but then this one's a bit dark, right? Okay. But then, yeah, that's what, let me not play around with it. Yeah, that's pretty much all you have to do here. That's pretty much all you have to do. I'll upload the code, right? I'll upload the code, and then all the best with your semester tests, right? See you next time.